It's the technology Elon Musk calls mind-bogglingly stupid. Could he have a point? Or are hydrogen cars set to be a threat to Tesla? Every single major manufacturer is either looking at or working on developing hydrogen cars. They have found that lithium-ion battery production for EVs is very energy intensive. For example, a 100 kilowatt-hour battery will give you about 250 miles, and producing that battery emits 20 tons of carbon dioxide. A typical battery lasts for around 150,000 miles, which equals 2 ounces of carbon dioxide per mile. Compared to that, hydrogen cars today have life cycle emissions that are pretty low. The Toyota Mirai, for example, emits 4 ounces of carbon dioxide per mile its entire lifetime. And even that can be cut down when hydrogen is produced from renewables. The exhaust gas from a hydrogen engine consists of pure water vapor, which means it is locally emission-free and keeps the air clean in cities. Sounds impressive, right? But the critics' first argument against hydrogen-powered cars is that they're less efficient than electric vehicles, and they might have a point there. The energy has to move from wire to gas to wire in order to power the car, a process called energy vector transition. Let's take 100 watts of electricity produced by a renewable source, like a wind turbine. To power a fuel cell vehicle, or FCEV, energy must be converted into hydrogen, possibly by passing through water, also called the electrolysis process. This is only around 75% energy efficient, so roughly 1/4 of the electricity is automatically lost. And the hydrogen produced must be compressed, chilled, and transported to the hydrogen station, a process that is around 90% efficient. Once inside the vehicle, the hydrogen needs to be converted into electricity, which is 60% efficient. Finally, the electricity used in the motor to move the car is around 95% efficient. You know what's left? Only 38 watts out of the 100 we started with. In contrast, EVs have their power come straight from the battery pack. The energy runs on wires all the way from the source of the car. The same 100 watts of power from the same source lose only 5% efficiency as it travels through the grid. You lose another 10% from charging and discharging the battery, plus another 5% from using the electricity to make the car move. You're still left with 80%, which is a lot more than 38. It all comes down to two things: battery cost and fueling infrastructure. Over the past decade, both these factors have seen massive changes. Despite getting a head start of over 50 years, starting with GM's Electrovan in 1996, hydrogen fuel cells remain low in volume, expensive to produce, and restricted to sales in the few countries or regions that have built-in hydrogen fueling stations. In contrast, just 10 years after the first electric vehicle went on sale, EVs sell in the low millions per year worldwide. They probably don't turn a decent profit as yet for founders, including Elon Musk, but General Motors and Volkswagen say that it is bound to change before 2030. If EVs find it hard to turn a profit even 10 years into the business, it might be even more challenging for hydrogen cars to start making big bucks. Hydrogen cars are more expensive to buy. The few models we have already available cost around $80,000 for a mid or upper mid-range car. In contrast, a Tesla Model 3 is just $35,000. The exception is perhaps the Toyota Mirai from 2019, which cost $50,000 in Japan, but only thanks to $20,000 worth of government subsidies. There are several reasons as to why they're so expensive. In addition to manufacturing in small volumes, there's also the need for platinum, a precious metal that acts as a catalyst during power generation. Another reason for the high price is that hydrogen fuel cell cars are larger because the hydrogen tanks take up a lot of space. The drive unit for a purely battery-driven EV, on the other hand, fits into small cars. That's why even classic electric vehicles can now be found in all vehicle classes. Additionally, though hydrogen is the most common element in the universe, it doesn't exist in its pure form. So if you want to use it as fuel for cars, it has to be extracted from other compounds, like water, natural gas, or fossil fuels. That requires the use of energy, and there are environmental and economic costs to that. Sadly, most of today's hydrogen fuel is obtained by natural gas reforming, which is cheaper than electrolysis. The process releases carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide, which counters the good it's trying to do. Plus, the extraction process can sometimes lead to methane leaks. they are not only 80 times worse than carbon dioxide, but it also has a bigger impact on the environment. Extracting the natural gas harms ecosystems, contaminates water, and even causes earthquakes. Yeah, it's quite a considerable risk to take on. Operating costs also play a massive role in cost effectiveness. At present, 1 pound of hydrogen costs around $14 in the United States, compared to $4 in Germany. An FCEV can drive around 28 miles on a pound of hydrogen. The cost per mile of running hydrogen cars, in that case, is twice as high as that of EVs charged at home. But if the demand for these cars increases, the price could drop to $2.50 for a pound by 2030. But there's more to worry about than cost. As environmentally friendly as driving a hydrogen car may be, the conditions under which hydrogen fuel cells are produced may not be. Hydrogen production requires electrical energy, which is used to break water down into its constituent elements, hydrogen and oxygen, via the process of electrolysis. If the electricity used comes from renewable sources, hydrogen production will have a neutral carbon footprint. But if fossil fuels are used for the process, it pretty much negates all the good a hydrogen car would do. How strong that effect depends on the energy mix used, and in this respect, they wouldn't be that different from electric vehicles. Right now, there are around 5 million EVs on the roads, and sales have been skyrocketing, especially in the last 2 years. Sure, it's only 5% of the global total, but it's still leagues above hydrogen cars, which has achieved about 10,000 car sales worldwide. It's not a very attractive option. Hydrogen still has very few refueling stations, and building them is hardly going to be a priority while the pandemic rages on. In contrast to that, Tesla and NIO are both constantly upgrading battery technology to give faster charge times and longer ranges. NIO is building a facility where you can drive in and swap out your battery for a full one in less than 3 minutes. But why do we have such a lack of hydrogen fueling stations? After all, they charge a car faster than the electric grid can charge a Tesla. Hydrogen charging takes 5 to 10 minutes, while charging up a Tesla takes 30 minutes to give you an 80% battery. The Nissan Leaf takes a whopping 8 hours, so why the lack? Well, it's for the same reason we lack options in hydrogen cars. Hydrogen is difficult to store because it has low volumetric energy density. It is lighter than helium, but it needs to be made more energy dense to be useful for transportation. It also requires a more intricate process than electric car charging stations and petrol stations. A 40-ton truck can deliver 26 tons of gasoline, and one daily delivery is enough for even the busiest station. How much compressed hydrogen do you think the same 40-ton truck can carry? Put your guesses in the comments below. Done that? Okay, the answer is a measly 800 pounds. This is because the weight of the tank is capable of holding 200 atmospheres of pressure. And if the tank is in any way punctured or damaged, the resulting fireball would cover the length of a football field. Carrying it in lower amounts is ultimately safer for the driver, and really all of us. But it also means one station could require 15 deliveries a day. The cost of a truck transport just can't be justified at that point, because it would basically be exhibiting the same amount of carbon dioxide. A cryogenic truck could theoretically carry more hydrogen, but the energy and money it takes to liquefy hydrogen also makes the process infeasible. So what does this mean for the future of hydrogen cars? As of 2018, there are three major brands of hydrogen cars available. You have the Toyota Mirai, the Hyundai Nexo, and the Honda Clarity. The Mirai gives you 312 miles on a full tank, and their global sales last year totaled 10,250, with most units sold in America. The Nexo and Clarity have ranges of 380 and 240 miles, respectively. And just this month, Jaguar Land Rover announced their intention to develop a hydrogen-powered car based on the new version of the Land Rover Defender. But it's nowhere near enough. For truly sustainable modes of transport, we have to tap into cleaner ways of producing hydrogen fuel cells and making these cars widely available to purchase. This technology is especially needed for heavy transport vehicles, since electric trucks are hindered by battery capacity right now. Sure, it would take billions of dollars and years of work, but there was a time when electric cars seemed impossible too. Fortunately, Jaguar and Japanese car companies aren't the only ones looking to develop hydrogen cars. Many others, like BMW, Mazda, General Motors, and Kia Motors are working on the technology, as are smaller firms like River Symbol. Would you drive a hydrogen car? Let us know in the comments below. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to hit subscribe and check out more like it on the Tech Monster channel. Thanks for watching.